Hello, everyone, and welcome to our webinar. We're gonna wait a few seconds here to get to see how everyone is joining. Usually takes about 30 seconds. To join.
So can people chat to us in the chat box?
Absolutely. If you want to send a message in the chat or use the QA function, we will monitor both of them. Please go ahead. I do have to tell you that some people have put messages in the chat, then you become public to others, and we have understood that some have been solicited services after a webinar, but if you want to say hi, please go ahead. All right, now it's 1 minute past. I wish you a very warm welcome to the Direct Booking Masterclass panel. We put this together because actually right today, Travolution and also shorttermrentals.com with a C, they published an article that says at Hostaway claims that direct bookings are on the rise. We had a look at our direct bookings, and the data is very consistent with, for example, data published by AirDNA. The overall percentage of bookings that come through direct sources as opposed to OTAs has roughly doubled from around 8% to 16% globally on all bookings in the last 2 years or over the pandemic. And as a result of that, property managers are investing more into getting direct bookings, nurturing it, getting better websites built. And that's why we wanted to put together this webinar, which is going to be interactive. Hello, Julie from Devon. You are free to ask any questions in the QA. We're even going to see if we can get some case studies in here. But we're going to have a brief discussion about why this is happening and what are some great tips. What can you as a property manager or owner do to get more direct bookings? And more importantly, why would people want to book direct? And why would you want to accept direct bookers? But before that, let's introduce ourselves. My name is Marcus from Hostaway. Hostaway is one of the leading property management systems and channel managers in the world of vacation rentals. We have thousands of property managers worldwide that use us for pretty much everything that their daily operations need. And we, in addition to that, we also have the largest marketplace in the vacation rental industry with over 100 integrated partners. And that's why I'm proud to say hi to two of our partners, Paul from ICND and Mark from Boostly. So Paul, why don't you introduce yourself?
I appreciate it. Thank you, Marcus. So I'm Paul from Intercoastal Net Designs, ICND for short. I'm the digital marketing director for the company, and we specialize in building vacation rental websites and digital marketing. So getting you to the top of Google, getting you found, getting you seen on your direct website. So been around for 25 years, coming up on 25 years anyway. Been in this industry for a while, and I've actually been in the industry for, geez, it's 15 years now. Now that I have to think about it, handling all marketing related aspects, getting people to your site and to book direct them. Off to you, Mark.
Oh, thanks for having me. And when I was asked to be part of this panelist, I was super excited because I always try and make sure I surround myself with people much cleverer than I when it comes to talking about the marketing and the industry. So first and foremost, to be part of this with Paul, who I've listened to the podcast, I'm a big fan of, and Marcus as well, as always, really impresses me with his knowledge of the industry, and the numbers that he's got to share is epic. So thank you for having me part of this. My name is Mark Simpson, and I founded a company called Boostly back in 2016. It's so amazing to see so many Team Boostly members in the chat. So if you are a member of Team Boostly and you are in the chat, leave a hashtag Team Boostly so I can see you. And we have got a panelist full of accents. We've already had someone compliment Marcus on his accent. We've got Paul with his lovely American accent and mine with my messed up British accent. So Really excited to be part of it, talking about my favorite topic, which is direct bookings. And I'm also as well author of the Book Direct Playbook. So it's perfect time to be talking about this. Very happy to say number one Amazon bestseller. So very happy to be part of this topic and discussion, and looking forward to learning more from everybody part of it. So thank you very much for inviting me.
All right, thank you. So now we're ready to start. And for anyone who's wondering, we are going to record this and put it on YouTube so you can always watch later. And we are going to take as many questions as possible. Right now, there's only one question in the QA section of Zoom and it's already been answered. Thank you very much for asking, but please go and put your questions there. I'm gonna kick it off with a couple of questions and each of us three will get to share some insights. And I hope that that you get some follow-up questions to add on later. We're aiming at around 45 minutes, but we don't have an exact time limit on this webinar, so you can keep them coming. So the first question that I have is, why are direct bookings up? Maybe we start with Mark this time.
Well, I know we're going to have some look at some data and things to back this up, but my personal opinion, the reason why direct bookings are up is a number of factors. Number one, hosts, just like everybody that's on this chat, Team Boostly members and other hosts from around the world are paying more attention to it on the back of the pandemic. Obviously, we all know what happened in 2020 with OTAs cancelling our policies and making it easier for guests to cancel. Plus as well, it got to a point in the pandemic, especially in the UK, where the OTAs had closed off any availability on their calendar. So if people were traveling, whether it is a healthcare professional or a business guest or somebody that was in relocation like I was, you had to find the property and book direct. So the offset of that and what happens on the guest point of view is that for a lot of people who were very reliant, and talking guests here, on booking via OTAs in the past, when they wanted to go and stay somewhere, they'd go, you know what, I'll just check booking.com, I'll just check Airbnb. They were having to click around or having to do a bit of research, and on the back of that, they'll have stayed with a property. And if we couple that with hosts now who are getting more educated themselves when it comes to email marketing, when it comes to a direct booking website, when it comes to social media, they now know the tools and tactics and training on how to keep in contact with a guest after they've stayed, how to remarket and how to get guests to come back. I feel like that's one of the main contributing factors that has driven the direct booking numbers up. So it's a long way around of answering the question. To summarize, I would say that number one, guests getting more savvy of how to book, but also hosts being more savvy when it comes to the marketing around, when it comes to attracting guests.
Yeah, you're pretty spot on with that one. I mean, the education is probably the biggest factor, right? So we're talking about, and we've seen this gradually happen. We've seen, you know, direct bookings increase year over year, even before the pandemic. So, you know, we are on our websites, we're constantly looking at our analytics. We're looking at the landing pages and we're looking at what people are looking at whenever they visit our websites. And, you know, we've got clients that have, you know, anywhere from 10 properties to 500 properties to 1,000 properties sometimes on these sites. And it's been very interesting and awesome to see, actually, that the property pages themselves, one of the 200 properties or whatever, those property pages are actually growing year over year as landing pages. So which means people are finding the names of these properties. They're remembering the names of these properties, whether it's from an OTA or a previous experience or whatever. They're Googling the name of the property itself, not the rental company. They're Googling the name of the property. So they're finding that property to book direct because of the guest education, because of book direct today, because we're doing a good job, right? As marketers, as hosts, as rental managers at touting that, you know, it is good to book direct. And the more we can keep that snowballing, the better. Definitely going into the future. We use OTAs for a reason, and they're good at what they do. They're very good at getting in, you know, getting in new guests. And it's kind of our job, though, to keep that going. And with so many new faces in the vacation rental atmosphere, especially in the States, I think it was 50% is the stat that I heard. 50% of people tried a vacation rental last year versus a hotel or something else. That's a lot. That's a lot. So it's going to keep growing. And our industry is in the VR space is mainstream now, you know, in that sense. So.
All right. Before I get into the question on why direct bookings have improved, I wanted to share some, well, my views on OTA. So first of all, an OTA means online travel agency, but in this context of this webinar, what you probably know it as is Airbnb, Vrbo, Booking.com, previously HomeAway, TripAdvisor, these kind of sites that are really two-sided marketplaces. So, the interesting part and why I wanted to mention this is that you may think that they sell a travel experience or that they sell an accommodation to a guest, but that's not actually their business model. Their business model is buying and selling marketing. So what they spend their money on is not like you think. You think that Airbnb pays you for someone staying there. That's not their business model. They pay Google, they pay lots of advertising methods to find travelers. And what they get in return is, of course, what they sell them. So they're basically marketing agencies. Now, they are extremely good marketing agencies. In fact, they are the best marketing agencies. They do have the biggest share. But that doesn't mean that you can't compete, because anyone who has a property has something unique that that these OTAs don't have. First of all, their main business is taking care of that property, renting it out, and not being a marketing agency. But more importantly, they have knowledge that's needed. And it's very interesting what Mark mentioned there, that that there was no availability of these properties on the OTAs in the about 2 years ago. There was clearly a catalyst there where travelers or consumers trusted these OTAs and property managers and hosts as well. And that trust was broken, because no matter how it was handled, whether it was handled in like Vrbo did or like Airbnb did, someone thought it was handled badly. And that's never nice when you're a middle manager and you need to make a decision between a rock and a hard place is a good expression for that. But because of that distrust, a lot of travelers decided to book directly, and they found out that it actually has a lot of advantages. Now, at the same time, the improvement in technology, Mark, you started in 2016. You're not the only one, and there's a lot of technology available for this, and that is something that has helped companies come out. The third one is that I think limitations in supply. Paul, you touched upon there that people don't want to go to hotels. That's right. You can book a hotel, but the flip side of the coin is it's pretty hard to book a vacation rental, because if you have a certain destination in mind and you have a certain type of property in mind, it's very likely that you're not going to be able to go, especially if you have a certain time frame in mind, you're not going to be able to go to a big website and book a good property in that location for that time. However, if there is a large property manager, you can call them, you can go on their website, and they can give you recommendations. And they might even say, well, if you like that area, we don't have anything there, but this area will work instead. And actually what I'm seeing, I spent the winter here in Florida, and because everything is rented out for next winter, for 2023, what people are doing is they're bartering. They're not even going directly to the property manager. They're going directly to other guests and say, hey, you know, I really want next February, but it's gone. Hey, you wanna change? You know, there's third party market now for vacation rentals. That's how popular it is. But excellent answers. Let's see if we have any questions from the audience here. Are people finding the name of the property to search? I think Paul, what you said, that was spot on. That's exactly what I'm seeing as well, and what we're seeing, the repeated or an increase in repeat guests. And at the same time, people don't suddenly want to travel around because there's a lot of uncertainty. Instead, they just want to go to the same place. It's comfortable enough. But then Yeah, could you elaborate a bit on that? How do people find individual properties?
You've got there's two sets of vacationers, right? Well, there's a lot of sets, but there's two sets. So there's the ones that always go to the same destination and or same property year after year. And that's really dependent on the market. You know, there's some markets like the Outer Banks that's most of the market is repeat guests over and over. This year was an interesting year because they had a lot of new guests. And, you know, there's always economic factors. You know, there's a new TV show that came out called Outer Banks on Netflix. There's, you know, a whole bunch of stuff happening. But the kind of the overall story, though, is with destinations like that, you know, those kind of, I don't want to say take care of themselves, but people aren't finding them. The new people are finding them just naturally, either through Googling Outer Banks rentals or just trying to find something, trying to find something in that area, because there's not a big OTA dominance in that area. Whereas when we're going to, we'll say Destin, Florida, or anything in the Panhandle, there's a lot of them. OTAs there. Now, it's kind of dependent on what time frame we're in. If we're talking about 5 years ago, then that's back when Vrbo and other OTAs allowed you to put the name of your property on, you know, so that you can have your property name, and then people were Googling the property name. There's others that are savvy enough to know that, like, you can copy or paste parts of the text that's on the listing on the OTA into Google and find that original property if you don't have them varied up in your property management system. And you can go by address or location or you know, stuff like that too. So everything is Googleable in the most part. But that's where that line is from the users that have been coming to you for year after year. They're the ones that are going to be finding the property names because they know, right? We've seen a growth in our industry. We've seen a growth in OTA bookings just in general. And with that being said, it's because all that, I call it new blood, all the new vacationers are turning to OTAs as well and growing that market. It's up to us to get them to book direct again next year, next year, next year. So, you know, it's an interesting, I guess, turn of events is how it's happening, but it's on a path to where we do have to keep pounding the book direct pavement, the hashtag book direct pavement.
I would love to piggyback on what Paul's saying here, because this is something really important for everybody listening to. And there's always a couple of scenarios. And what Paul's saying and what Marcus was alluding to is spot on. If you've got somebody that is traveling to your location where your properties is for the first time, as in they haven't got any contacts, they've never been there before, they don't know anybody that's been to the area, they are going to go to where they know, and they're going to go to a brand, i.e. Airbnb, i.e. booking.com, i.e. Vrbo, whatever they've used before in the past. And you've just got to suck that up. Now, what you're hoping for is that guest, that future potential guest that's coming to the area where your property or properties are, is coming back for a repeat time, or is coming on the back of a recommendation or referral. So for example, just imagine the scenario, me and Marcus were in our office together. I've just mentioned over to Marcus, hey, I've just been to Myrtle Beach. I've gone and stayed at this amazing place. It's Paul's property. You should go and check it out. Now, what they're going to do is they're going to go onto Google, and they're going to Google Paul's property in Myrtle Beach, right? Now, what you need to do here, which is really important, you got to make sure that when that person Googles Paul's property Myrtle Beach, is that your business needs to be at the top of Google. Now, there's a couple of things that you can do for that. Number one, get a Google business listing. It's super simple to do. Bearing in mind that Google are going to change everything and call it Google Vacation Rentals in the very near future, but Google business listing, you can still get it, you can still have it, and you can still activate it, and it can still be visible. So that's number one, get the Google business listing. If you don't know what it is, if you need help setting it up, I've got a free video on YouTube that will show you exactly how to set it up. Just send me a message on Instagram at Boostly UK, or send me an email, and I'll make sure you get that link. That's no problem at all. marketbooster.co.uk. The second thing that you need to do is you need to be taking advantage of the bid on brand strategy. Now, the bid on brand strategy, like Paul obviously does a lot of Google Google PPC within the company, but this is something that everybody can do, and it's super, super cheap to do. And the reason why this is important, and I found this out our family business. So for anybody who doesn't know who I am, my career with Boostly started in 2016. When it came to hospitality, I've been in this since the age of five, many, many years. I've been in and around full time in the family business since 2011. And one of the things that always used to irk me is that when somebody Google searched our business name, then booking.com and TripAdvisor and Expedia were advertising on our brand name on Google. So even if somebody was coming and a repeat visitor and they were Googling the Granary in Scarborough, these OTAs were coming above us because they were bidding on our brand name on Google. So I was like, well, what do we do here? So I figured out a strategy where we would bid on brand, and we fought fire with fire. And the cool thing about bid on brand is that you're spending pennies instead of pounds, because it's a very, very, very low cost to bid on. Now, I'm not going to spend 10, 15, 20, 30 minutes talking about how to do bid on brand. Very, very simply, if you want to figure out how to do it, it will cost you less than a tenner. It's called the Book Direct Playbook. Go find it on Amazon, go and buy it, because I've literally laid it all out in this book. But it is so beneficial for you to start doing so, because Google, whether you like it or not, you've got to start treating Google like your homepage. So when somebody will Google Paul's property, Myrtle Beach, you've got to make sure that you're sending people to your business, your website, your brand, and not go into the OTAs. Because again, when you sign that little T's and C's that nobody reads to sign up to Airbnb, to Vrbo, to booking.com, there's a section on there that states that you are allowing them to bid on your brand name on Google. So that's really, really important to make sure that you're doing, and a lot of people aren't. So now again, go back to the first thing that I said, just to finish off my little segment here. The first thing that I said is that if there's a guest coming to your area for the first time, they don't know anybody, they don't know you, they don't know anybody who's been to the area, you are going to have to suck it up and get that booking through via an OTA if your property stands out on the OTAs and whatnot. But if that guest ever does repeat and come back, and if they ever repeat and come back to you and book via an OTA, then this is your fault. And this is where a webinar like this and a masterclass like this will help educate you to make sure that that guest will never, ever book with you again via an OTA, will book with you every single time directly. And I started doing this in 2016, and those numbers that Marcus has will be a lot lower than with direct bookings. And it's so happy for me to see those numbers going up and up and up, because it shows to me that hosts are getting educated in email marketing. They're getting educated in how to take a guest that stayed with you before and market to them to get them to come back directly. So long may it continue. And hopefully this number keeps going up and up and up and up over the years. So yeah, really, really good signs, but some really important things that you need to be doing.
There's another trend that that will already is and will accelerate this, and that's actually regulation. So when you look at where, let's say you wanted to rent a house or a home 5 or 10 years ago, you could go pretty much everywhere. But what's happening since is that that's in a lot of places you can't use homes for that purpose anymore. I mean, if you want to try to find one in San Francisco, I can only wish you good luck. It's just not a viable travel destination. Now, what that in turn means is that Myrtle Beach is all the more an attractive location, for example, because they allow that. But also specifically, when you start looking at neighborhoods or even streets or near some parks, those are good brand names to use if they are in areas that are friendly, where you know that, because you don't want to find a nice place for vacation and then find out you can never go there again. Instead, you want to find a place that you can use. Let's say if you don't go there many times, at least you have it as a backup. Maybe your plan A isn't possible, maybe it's sold out, but then you have a backup to go on vacation. And these type of names, they can be neighborhoods, they can be individual buildings. If you don't create it yourself, you can even use a resort name if you have units inside a resort. And yeah, the more regulation there is, the more the demand will be only on those properties. Now, there's a really good, keep putting questions here. We have a lot of questions. We'll get to them soon. But let's take the following question that we had prepared a little bit for. what kind of trends are you seeing right now when it comes to direct bookings? And I can start, I can say one big trend that we're seeing is that property managers, they not only want to, but they're also able to upsell various features. And that's a very interesting phenomenon, because there's a, when you look at long-term consumer trends, you often see that the power is with the company or the power is with the consumer. For example, right now, if you want to buy a new car, it's very hard. You might have to wait 1 year or 6 months to get that car, which means the power is with the company. The consumer doesn't have the power. But right now, actually, the in vacation rentals, there's a lot of consumers who say, you know, I don't want to go and pick and choose. I don't want to take this specific type of property over here. Instead, I'd like things recommended to me. So those who have the ability, and even Airbnb caught on this many years ago. This is a long-term trend when they started Airbnb experiences to, you know, suggest, why don't you take a cooking class in Porto, in Portugal? That's a great idea. But property managers are doing the same thing. They're just suggesting, why don't you rent our bikes? Why don't you book a boat tour as well? And people accept that because it has changed. And that's a trend that will be interesting to see. But that's at least what we're seeing, that the amount of upsold services, extra cleanings, early check-in, late checkout is increasing. How about you, Paul or Mark?
Very, very high ADR comparatively. You know, everybody's raising their rates. And it's quite interesting because, I mean, we service a lot of clients throughout the United States, coast to coast, and we have international clients as well. And what we've noticed, and the interesting part is that pretty much everybody has raised their rates in some way, shape, or form. There's a few clients that have stuck to where they were previous years, but pretty much everybody has raised their rates. Now, what's happened is there's been so many advanced bookings going on, and I'm talking October, November, December of last year, people booking for the summer for these beach destinations. There was a lot of advanced bookings going. So when January 1st hit, with these raised rates, which is, you know, usually the big prime time for bookings in the US is January. So with these raised rates, there's a lot of repeat clients that are coming back that are saying, ooh, this is too much, too high. I don't want to spend that same amount of money. I don't want to spend $3,000 more on the same property that I just stayed in last year. So we kind of have an impasse here, whereas we have these, I don't want to say inflated properties, but these properties with higher rates comparatively. So the older guests, the guests that I've talked about have stayed years and years in the past, are kind of being pushed out due to demand of the younger guests, the ones that they don't know any better, but the ones that are actually booking and putting that money down. So the demand is there no matter what we do. That's a good thing, obviously. It's just a matter of living up to that expectation of that $8,000 a week home or, you know, that kind of mentality. That's kind of what I'm seeing as far as the booking pace actually slowing down in January. Occupancy is still great in the summer, but the pace itself, especially compared to last year, is down. But it's just, it's going to catch up to itself. And I have no doubt about that.
So what you're saying is getting repeat guests has suddenly become the worst case scenario, where you get the place booked, but they're paying a lower price than anyone else on the market would pay.
Right, right. Yeah, so there's some companies that are keeping their rates for their previous guests, like they're holding that rate. Other companies are not. They're just raising the rates and getting everybody they can, anybody they can.
So you're saying it's time to start booking the getaways for 2024 and locking in the rate now?
Yep.
All right.
If you look at the reasons why this is happening, I mean, if you just look back to last summer and look back to back end of last year, properties were going so quickly because when coming out of lockdowns or coming out of situations or restrictions are lowering, people just want to go away on vacation. You've got to think about why we do this for the most part. We are creating memories. We create the memories that you and your guests will remember for years to come. I mean, you instantly think about a vacation of like the family vacation that you took in whenever, and we are creating it. And so when people couldn't go on these vacations, couldn't get away, they are literally ready to book there and then. And because of that, the price goes up because there's, you know, fantastic pricing software tools now available that are helping hosts for the first time in a long time, which is great. But for the guests themselves, they'll have gone away, say October. They'll have had a really hard time finding a place or really hard time getting it for a half decent rate. So as soon as they come away from it and say that it's a reunion and go, right, we'll definitely do that next year. In the past, say in 2019, they'll have gone on that holiday. They'll have all agreed verbally, yeah, we'll all meet again. But they wouldn't have done anything until January, which Paul alluded to. January is normally the peak booking month because everybody wakes up after their New Year hangover. They shake it down and go, right, where are we going this year? This time, people have already booked this year's stay in October, November, December. It's why you come into the hospitality community Facebook group, which is our group, and people were saying about, you know, people are booking already. And Linda dropped in the comments that it's all well and good putting your prices up on these automatic pricing tools. But when you've got a guest who calls you up or emails you or messages you, who's been with you 3-5 years on the row, and they're calling up to book their stay, it's really hard to go, you know what, Mr. Guest who stayed with us 3 or 4 or 5 times, you know, we know your name, we know your family, you know us, to then go, actually, that price is going to be $3,000 or 3,000 euros more expensive. You can't do that because the human in you comes out. So there's, you know, you've always got to look at the numbers. You've always got to look at all of this and then just add in that context, because every single one of us has been in hospitality in some way, shape or form. Everybody has been there, done that. So you've got to try and find the right mix. And, you know, it's a really hard situation to put yourself in. Like what Linda says, when somebody contacts you who stayed with you 3, 4, 5, 6 years in a row, and they're going to come and book for 2022. And, you know, you want to keep it with the current demand, and the prices obviously are going up because inflation is going up and all that jazz. But at the same time, you've got a guest on the phone. So, you know, it's a really tricky one to have. Sometimes those guests that have been with you for so long, it may be a case of where you've got to bite the bullet on it. But again, you cannot put a price on a repeat guest coming back time and time again, because they are your ultimate and your best form of referrals and marketing, if you look after them and treat them properly, like every single one in here is doing.
Thank you very much. We had a couple of other questions prepared, but I think it's time to let our audience join in. When looking at the chat, a lot of people are agreeing that return guests are, of course, going to pay less if the prices are going up. There seems to be an undertone here of uncertainty overall looking forward. Some seem to be wondering, is this a bubble? And I think the language you used, Paul, is that it's overheated or something similar, that, you know, is this going to go away? What's going to happen? And Kevin from Silicon Valley is asking, what's going to happen with business travel? I think before we dive into the more specific questions, I think this is a topic that's worth talking about, because Mark, like you said, this is a once in a lifetime opportunity. But I think what's on everyone's mind here is, yeah, but what's going to happen next? I mean, how are the bookings going to look in 2024? And I'm going to start, because I have a fairly short answer to that question. I know a lot of people in the industry, both in vacation rentals and in the travel industry overall, they are of the firm opinion that nothing has fundamentally changed, that we are it's going to take some time, but we're going to be at 2019 very soon. Just to give an example, Expedia, they had their earnings report from the last quarter. They're still at 17% below in terms of revenue from 2019. So travel hasn't recovered. Of course, vacation rentals are booming, but my argument is that the world has fundamentally changed, and especially when it comes to consumer behavior. There is a percentage of all the travelers in the world that have started to do things differently, and there is a percentage of those that will never go back to the old ways. And to give just a practical example, I'm sure you all know someone who's been living in a big city and they moved out to a small town during the last 2 years. Now, that's millions of people around the world. If they all decided to move back tomorrow and go back to 2019, those property prices on the countryside would plummet and the city prices would skyrocket. Somewhere around halfway, the other half wouldn't be able to do it anymore. Same thing with travel. That's why we're seeing that that vacation rentals are fully booked right now, because everyone wants to book them and the prices are going up. But it's not going to go back to normal anytime soon. And to answer your question, Kevin, I firmly believe that business travel will be back, but will companies invest in traveling to Silicon Valley as much as they did before? That I don't think so. I think there needs to be a different format for that. And I would continue tracking the data, looking at, for example, Expedia's, because Expedia does everything. They do rentals, flights, hotels. So look at their revenues in different regions and see what's happening. So I don't think we're going to go back to normal ever again. I think this is the new normal. What about Paul and Mark?
Yeah, we're in a bubble right now, but we'll always be there. There'll always be a new normal now, right? I think you're spot on, especially the way real estate's changing hands and just everything moving right now. We're good. We're set at the moment. But as everything, it smooths itself out over the years, you know, when travel returns and hotels and you know, there's only so much, if we keep this bubble going, there's still only so many properties out there, unless we build another 10 million over the next couple of years, right? So that supply is a lot lower than demand right now, and it's going to even itself out eventually, especially with international travel coming as well.
Yeah, I think that this question is such a hard question to answer, because just like with everything over the last 2 years, everybody just has to look, and everybody's looking at their own town, their own city, their own area. And when you talk about business travel, and for some people, business travel hasn't been affected in any way, shape or form for them and their own business. If anything, business guests has gone up, because the leisure market has dropped. But if for anything and any type of guest that could travel and still move around when lockdowns were going on, it was healthcare professionals and business guests that needed to travel, and they were allowed to travel with restrictions. And plus as well, they couldn't stay in big hotels, or the company didn't want them staying in big hotels because then they would be at more risk. So they were staying in apartments or vacation rentals. So what has happened, like Paul mentioned, what has happened over the last couple of years, whatever we come out of this, we're never going to have 2019 again. 2019 was 2019. The world was such a different place. Liverpool's was winning Champions Leagues in 2019. Who knows when that's going to happen again, all right? So we're now coming out on the other side of this, right? And what is going to come out of it is that so, and Paul has already alluded to it, so many more people have gone from hotels into vacation rentals in some way, shape, or form, apartments, houses, whatever you want to call it. So they've been, for the first time, they've gone, okay, well, I'm not staying at the insert large hotel chain. I'm now going to be staying at a vacation rental, and that may stay. So there is so much demand. And supply-wise, there's so many more people now interested in this model. So you've got landlords who have had a property, but whether they're renting it out long-term, who are now getting property managers coming to them and saying, listen, look at these numbers, look at the demand. Instead of getting $650 a month for this one rental property, you can probably be earning $2,000 to $3,000. And so many more people are coming into it. It's going to grow and grow and grow, and everybody's going to be happy. And who knows what's going to happen with this bubble and what's going to come out on the offset. But as we come out of this, restrictions lower, people are going to go back to hotels, resorts, whatever that may be, go back on their cruises. And so maybe people may not stay in vacation rentals and guest houses as much. But the cool thing is it doesn't really matter, because you have only got, everybody in this chat right now has only got a limited amount of supply. You've only got a limited amount of nights that you need to fill. So I think my one big ask of everybody, and my one big requirement, and the one thing that I want to see everybody in this room do coming out of this, is that you're going to get your customer avatar, your ideal guest, nailed down. If you try and adopt the 2019 tactic of just trying to appeal to everybody, you'll appeal to nobody. So what I want everybody to do is to figure out, why would somebody come to your area? Who's the type of person that will come to your area? And then what does your property offer and who will it appeal most to? And then really double down on that with the marketing. So make sure you're following Paul and ICND. Make sure you're following Boostly, the Boostly YouTube channel. You know, if you've got a spare $10, please do go pick up the book, the book Direct Playbook on Amazon. Because this, we will help you. You know, this is why we all come together in these webinars, and we come together in these Zooms, and we do these lot, because I truly believe that we can get this book direct number even higher, double what it is right now. But all we need to do is we need to start really putting our business hats on now, really putting our marketing hats on, and figure out who we really are appealing to and really go for it. Because I guarantee the hosts that do come out of this absolutely loving life.
Thank you, Mark. Sounds like you've been listening to my new YouTube series there, Go and Know Who Would Book the Ideal Customer Profile. Now, in order to get through these questions, there's a lot of good questions here, and I think we won't get through them all if we get three views on everything. So what I suggest now is that I'm going to take a couple of questions that are related, and Paul and Mark, you can look through and then answer one or a few in one on the QA section. So I'm going to pick up the questions here about pricing on both OTAs and direct bookings. Brendan is asking, how should we handle pricing? Is it just to get more occupancy, and do you make more money than if you were booked through an OTA? Then we've got Paul Graham asking, how would you know if it's better markets for direct bookings? And someone also asked, how do you set the rates on different OTAs, and does it hurt your ranking? So what the setup that I would recommend is that, assuming that you are using OTAs, you might be in an area where you never need to, but most of us are not in that an exclusive area. Let's say a private island where there's only one house. In that case, probably you can get fully booked as long as everyone knows that island. When it comes to the pricing, I would definitely recommend using a software such as Hostaway, and then using a dynamic pricing provider that measures the demand in real time and the supply, and is able to adjust your rates. But then you apply different markups. It means that, let's say you get a certain rate for next Saturday night, and then a certain percentage higher on different ODAs. Now, to answer the question on whether that puts you lower in the search rankings, not necessarily. So obviously price is going to determine how high up you come. But on the other hand, if you're the only property that's available next Saturday, then people are going to book it assuming that it's within their budget. It doesn't matter if there used to be another property or 10 that were cheaper, because those are all rented out, maybe because they were too cheap. And keep in mind, the OTAs, if you have a higher price and someone books it, they make more money. And I also wanted to address the question about, okay, well, how do you make money on the direct bookings? And someone had commented earlier on that the OTAs take a large cut. Keep in mind what I said earlier, their marketing engine. If they get, let's say, 15 or 20% of your booking, but there's no supply, next Saturday is fully booked in the entire region, then they make zero. They make 15% out of zero. So they don't have any money to advertise. But if there's a situation where there is availability, they are saving up that money and they're going to spend it. So it's good to have a mix there. That's, I think I answered a few of them. Now, maybe Paul or Mark, you go ahead and pick a few questions from the Q&A section.
I've got one that I would love to answer, and it was Karen's right at the very, very, very start. And I feel like because Karen was one of the first ones to put a question, and we should answer it. And the question is this. So for those of you who can't see it, I'll just repeat it. But before I answer this question, I've got a little challenge for everybody that's watching this right now. We've got a lot of people tuning in. So what I would love for everybody to do, if you would like a free bit of training from me, I'm more than happy to send you a free bit of training, that bid on brand one that I told you about earlier, but I need for you to do something. If you could take your camera out right now. So I just took a little picture. So take a little picture of the Zoom of our lovely faces, Marcus, Paul's and I's. Take a little picture and then go upload it on Instagram stories and tag in @BoostlyUK. And if someone could please put @BoostlyUK in the chat box, if you tag it in, I'll get a direct message. And then what I'll do is for everybody that does that, and I get that direct message to show that you have done it, I'll send you that little bid on brand video, exactly how to set it up. But I need for you to do that one thing for me. So the question is this, how do I target older generation guests who is not tech savvy? Our guests are mostly grandparents booking for the family. This, Karen, if you're still with us, is super simple. It's super obvious when I tell you it. So many people don't do it anymore, but it's one of the most effective things that every single one of you can do right now to get bookings. And you're going to kick yourself when I tell you it, because you'll literally have one of these in your hand right now. And that is call your guests. Let's go old school on this one. They are the older generation who don't know TikToks, that don't know your Instagrams, they don't know the voice notes, but I tell you what they do know, picking up the phone and having a conversation with them. Now, Airbnb, booking.com, Vrbo, they don't share with you the email address, but they do share with you the phone number. And we have to take advantage of that, because I can see a point in time where Airbnb will stop sending you the phone number because they want all that communication to be done within the app. They will clock onto the fact that a large amount of us pick up the phones and call our guests, and that's how we get them to flip to a direct booking. So there's only going to be a point in time when they take that away. And when Airbnb acts, you can guarantee that the other ones will do so as well. So please take advantage of that while you've got it. If you're using Hostaway, you're obviously going to go and pull a report off of all of your guests that have stayed with you in the past year. Okay, super easy to do, nice and easy. And then what you're going to do is just call your guests. So if you've had somebody that stayed with you and they are the older generation that you're talking about, pick up the phone, give them a call and just have a conversation with them. And just, you know, especially if you interact with your guests, as in you meet and greet them, you chat to them, you email them, you send them a letter, a Christmas card, they will already recognize your voice and they will already recognize the business because they've stayed with you. That know, like, and trust factor is there. And all you're simply going to do is just going to ask if they're looking to come back and stay with you again this year. Have you made plans for your 2022 vacation? And the conversation will go a couple of ways. It can last for 5 minutes, or if you know, you're speaking to my grandparents, that'll last for hours. But anyway, once you're having the chat with them, you can ask them if they're going to come back. And if they say no, then all you're going to do is say, do you know anyone? So yeah, no problem. No problem, you're not going to come back. But do you know anyone who's looking for a vacation or a holiday to where we are? And again, they'll either say yes or they'll say no. And if they can recommend you, fantastic. Now, also as well, you've got to think, and this is why I talk about customer avatar, and it's really important. You've got to, when you do this training, and again, if you're gonna take away anything from what I say, the first part of this book is all about customer avatar. You've got to really put your mind set into your future potential guest, your ideal guest. And if yours is the older generation, and you've got to think about, well, are they going to be on social media all the time? Are they going to be doing X, Y, and Z? Or should you be looking to do another tactic, which would be print advertising? Again, you've got to really put your mindset into it. One of the things that we did, and our ideal guest, our core guest at our family business, was the older generation, because they would come and stay with us all the way throughout the year. They would fill up our weekdays, and then at weekends, we would get the families. So what we did, which was really effective, is that we looked at all of our booking reports. We looked at where all of our guests were coming from. And back then, I didn't have fancy reports from Hostaway. I had to do this on pen and paper. So I would get all of the little, a little sheet that we'd get every guest to fill in. And I had like 1,000 that I went through, and I just sorted them out into postcodes or cities or towns. And what I discovered is that 20% of our guests were coming from 80% of our guests were coming from 20% of locations. So our family business was Scarborough, United Kingdom. and they were coming from Leeds and Newcastle and Sheffield. For those of you who don't know United Kingdom, and I've just listed off those three places, I do apologize, but Leeds, Sheffield and Newcastle. So what I did is I looked at the publications and the newspapers and the magazines that were in those areas. And all I did is I called them up and I asked if we could do a bit of marketing and do a bit of ad spend. Now, 10 years ago, that was really expensive. Now, because everybody assumes that print is dead cheap. It's really cheap to do it. They will actually love for you to give them some money because nobody else is. So all you need to do is to really put yourself into your guest shoes, find out where the majority of your guests are coming from and find out how you can get in front of the eyes, whether that's a print ad or doing something else. Maybe you want to call the local bowls club in the place where all your guests are coming from. Because again, you'd think about, again, the older generation, they love playing a game of garden bowls. So can you maybe call up the local bowls club, introduce yourself and ask if they ever do any tours and they come to your area? These little things like that will really make a difference in getting your business out there and what's called the billboard effect.
Thank you very much, Mark. Now, Paul, would you like to answer a question?
Yeah. Actually, I wanted to also answer that same one, but I'll keep mine very short. What happens when an older generation gets a new computer from their children? Do they go to Google to find things? New computers are Microsoft computers. They're searching on Bing. They're using the Microsoft Ads platform. Our conversion rate on Bing is 2 to 3 times that of the conversion rate on Google when you do pay-per-click. And it's specifically that generation, the older generation, because they don't know how to go to Google. They just open up the browser and start typing things, and Bing is what shows them the results. So that's a real quick one. It's if you're doing pay-per-click and you want to target those, then yeah, go for Bing. one of the questions from the other Paul Graham, how do you know which markets are direct markets versus OTA markets? And to answer that just real quick, it's just a matter of, I've kind of learned to see it by Googling it. If you Google the market and you see in the, and we're talking, I'll use Outer Banks, for example. If you Google Outer Banks rentals, Outer Banks vacation rentals, there's very little presence on the first page for Airbnb or Vrbo or any other, you know, online travel agency. There's all local companies. So those kinds of markets are the ones that are tough. So Google yourself, Google your own market with what you think people might be searching for. And that's how you can get to that answer. How much competition is out there for that. They're still going to spend money advertising, getting you to those, getting bookings no matter where you are. So, and is that necessary evil? Just like Mark said, it's needed, but, and then the other one, I just wanted to talk about real quick was, kind of getting the max potential, from a Hostaway direct booking platform. And then there's the, now, obviously, we don't use Hostaway's booking platform. We integrate with Hostaway. But there's so many different ways that you can tailor a website to what you need, right? And we've actually got a here's my sales pitch. We've actually got a checklist for 59 things that you can do to increase direct bookings. And these are from a marketing perspective. They're from a on site, on your website perspectives, stuff like that, everything you can check off that'll get you those bookings. I'm going to put that in the chat real quick for you. And, so you can go to that one. And then the one last one, there's real quick. I'm just kind of burning through them real quick. There's a, someone anonymous said, asked me about, helping ways to, help VRMs educate guests about the benefits for booking direct, what tips. So actually I have a blog post that I just wrote recently that has exactly that. real quick, there's I'll put the link in there in a sec, but As a quick way, build a dedicated page on your website. Every time a guest comes to you actually, build that dedicated page. Make sure that you have links to that page throughout your website so people can see it. And Mark and I discussed this last time. Once the person is in your rental, have a fridge magnet, right? Have a pop-up tent on the coffee table. Hey, did you know you could have saved $500 by booking direct? So you're educating that guest for next year. And that's it's not that much of an investment. So, you know, if you can't get that email address, if you can't get that that phone number, you still have to get in front of them. And that's the only way to really get in front of them is right there in that unit, right?
All right. Thank you. I'd like to answer a question here. We have about 5 minutes left. Karen asked a question that I think is really good. She's concerned about risk and cost when offering direct bookings versus OTA. Insurance, I feel protected when using Airbnb. I think this sounds like a typical technology problem. You got to look at what technology partners are you relying on when you're running your vacation rental business, and most importantly, what type of solutions can they offer? So first of all, whether you get a guest through an OTA or directly, there's a lot of things that you need to do to make it a nice experience for the guest, but also for yourself. For example, you should be screening them. You should be signing a rental agreement. You should be having a strategy for how to deal with security deposits or fees. And this depends a bit on your business model. You know, how do you want to make money? If you own a property, probably most of the money you get is from the actual rent. But if you manage properties on behalf of others, there's many other ways of making money. And so talk to whoever is your vacation rental software provider about that. If there's someone like Hostaway that has over 100 partners, then they can recommend you exactly which insurance providers you should use. They can include the website. Actually, we did a big revamp of our booking engine. One of the big improvements there is that we're now able to integrate into any existing website. And what that means is that if you already have a website that's high up in Google, you can simply link the booking engine there. And that's something that has been really popular. But the advantage is then you get to connect it to any services, like mentioned, insurance, guest screening, and rental agreements, and so on. All right. Paul, Mark, you want to take another question?
Well, there's tons of questions. There's like 14.
Keep coming in.
There's only 12.
There's lots of them. So I think we've only got a couple of minutes left because obviously we want to finish on the hour. So what I will say to everybody, and we did talk about doing like a website review, but we're going to run out of time for that. So if anybody would like their website reviewing, I do a thing called Marketing Review Live. It's part of the Boostly podcast series that we do. So if you haven't or won't get a chance for your website to be reviewed and you'd like it to do so, just send me a message on Instagram at BoostlyUK. I'll send you a link and you can put your name down. I pick one person every month from our Facebook group and our community, the Boostly community. And we do a marketing review live, which is awesome. So again, just at BoostlyUK, send us a message. Don't forget to take that picture if you want to get that free training. But I think what's really important, I think for me, as we finish up, the takeaways that I feel that everybody should be having from this is that number one, the guests are getting more savvy. They're not just going straight to Airbnb, booking.com. They are clicking around. They are looking around. Your job and your responsibility is to make sure that you are visible everywhere. So if you are yet to get a property management software, go and speak to Hostaway, because when you're with a property management software and a channel manager, they will make sure that your business is visible everywhere. There's going to be a lot of people here that are just visible on Airbnb. You're building your house all on one land, which is never a good thing. You've got to make sure that you use Airbnb like you would use it like Facebook. It's just a marketing channel. So make sure you're listed everywhere. Our family business, we were a 200-acre farm, bed and breakfast, 14 bedrooms, 3 holiday cottages in the middle of nowhere. There's no way that we should have got the visibility that we did. But I piggybacked on booking.com. I piggybacked on TripAdvisor. I piggybacked on Airbnb when it came all popular in 2014 in the UK, to so that we could get visible. And yet we had to suck up and get in a booking straight away coming in from the OTAs for a long time. But as soon as somebody booked with us, I made sure that they never rebooked again with us via an OTA through doing email marketing, social media, et cetera, et cetera. And that's what everybody needs to start doing. Make sure you're visible everywhere. Make sure that when you get a person in your property, that they never rebook with you via an OTA. And that's going to be the core trick here. And what you want to do is you want to turn your business into a referral making machine, so that a guest has an amazing time. A guest goes home. Do you contact them at any point after they've left you asking for a review or a referral? And if the answer is no, start, because you'll be amazed at how many people will be happy to tell their friends, family, coworkers about you. You just need to ask. And as I always say, shy kids don't get sweets. So take with that what you can, and please put it into practice.
All right. I see that we're up on time. It was a pleasure to have everyone here. Nice Cindy to from findrentals.com, a great tool for advertising your direct booking website. Thanks, Cindy, for joining. Our next webinar is actually going to be on guest screening, which is very closely related to this. And there's a simple tip that I have if you ever feel like you might miss a Hostaway webinar. Just go to our website. There's a button there called Book a Demo. Just book a demo with our wonderful sales team. Get a demo. It's going to be one of the nice experiences that you have. But a side effect of it is you're going to make sure that you never miss another webinar in your life. But if you do, it's available on YouTube. And I just wanted to ask Paul, do you have any final words?
Keep on keeping on. Yeah, I'd just mirror what Mark said. So that's exactly what I would have said. So.
That's great. Well, Paul and Mark and Christopher, Esther, everyone who joined, sorry that we didn't have time to go through all the questions, but it's been really great here having you here, and see you next month. Bye.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.